This evening we gather around the seven last words of Christ, knowing that God is with us as we journey through this Good Friday. Please note that we will, again this evening, the lights will be dim as the service goes on, and we will leave in silence. We continue with the litany. We have all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Christ himself bore our sin in his body on the tree, that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. Surely there is not one righteous on earth who does good and never sins.
Christ himself bore our sins in his body on the tree, that we might die to sin and live to righteousness.
Like David, we must say, we have all sinned greatly in what we have done. But now, O Lord, we pray to you, take away the iniquities of your servants, for we have done very foolishly.
Christ himself bore our sins in his body on the tree, that we might die to sin and live to righteousness.
Christ redeemed us from the cure of the law, having become a cure for us, for it is written, accused be everyone who hangs on a tree.
In his love, not that we love God, but that God loved us and sent his Son to take the expiation of our sins.
Let us pray. Merciful God, your Son was lifted up on the tree
to draw all people to himself.
Grant that we who have been born out of his womb inside
may at all times find mercy in him, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Jesus. The first word. When they came to the place called the Skull, they nailed Jesus to the cross there, and the two criminals, one on his right and one on his left. Jesus said, "Forgive them, Father. They do not know what they are doing. They do not know what they are doing. They do not know. They who killed Jesus? Who is they? It is so easy to name others, to blame others. The Romans, the crowd, Pilate, Herod, Caiaphas, they all played their part and conspired against Jesus. Or simply followed orders to maintain the peace, to keep Jesus' kingdom from infringing on theirs. And that, yet where are we when Jesus' kingdom infringes on ours? On our peace and our order, on our prosperity and our security. Where are we when we are, when the victims of our peace cry for justice? When those disenfranchised by our order call for compassion? When the hungry and the lonely beg us to share our prosperity, our security, our power? Where are we when Jesus is crucified among us? Surely he should have raged out at the sinners who nailed him to the cross. Surely he should have raged at us for the evil we do, the evil both knowing and unknowing. Yet compassion is there in the first words that he utters. He intercedes for us before the Father. Compassion that called him into being in his mother's womb. Compassion that compelled him to the cross. Compassion that brings incredible, unbelievable grace. Compassion that echoes through the centuries to all who participate in the killing of Christ. Compassion that cries out from the cross, "Father, forgive them. They do not know what they are doing."
What grace love is this? the second word. One of the criminals hanging there threw insults at him. "Aren't you the Messiah? Save yourself and us." The other one, however, rebuked him, saying, "Don't you fear God? Here we are all under the same sentence. Ours, however, is only right, for we are getting what we deserve for what we did. But he has done no wrong." And he said to Jesus, "Remember me, Jesus, when you come as king." Jesus said to him, "I tell you this, today you will be in paradise with me." How much are we like the first thief? Full of anger because we are not rescued from our sin? Full of hate because we suffer because of the sins of others? How much do we want God to snap his fingers and make right what we have made wrong, what we have allowed others to make wrong? How easy it is to cry, "Save us," and to rail against God when there is no magic cure, no miraculous recovery, no legions of angels to take away pain and bring wholeness. How easy it is to scorn the Messiah, to mock the goodness of the world and condemn the light of the world, because we are unwilling to face what we have done. Yet there is goodness. There is a cure for sin, a cure that does not promise magical solutions, but promises that the pain of sin is not the end. That when all this is over, when the suffering is finished, that the final word is not torture and defeat, but life. Life springing out of the ashes, life transformed and fulfilled in paradise. To the compassionate thief, to the one who could still recognize the good in the world, to the one who tried to comfort and protect that good, to the one who sought good, comfort was given. Today you will be in paradise with me.
Thank you.
the third word. Standing close to Jesus' cross were his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. Jesus saw his mother and the disciples. This disciple he loved standing there, so he said to his mother, "Woman, here is your son." And from that time, the disciple took her to live in his home. Who can grasp the grief of Mary watching her son suffer, the grief of Mary watching him die? And who can grasp the grief of the son who must see his mother mourn? What gift can a man give his mother? What can he offer when he is gone? How can he help her, hold her, comfort her, honor her? Woman, here is your son. Here is one I love to love you and for you to love. One who knows me, one who is my brother and can speak of me. One who can hold you, comfort you, and honor you. One who shares your grief. Here is your mother. Here is one I love for you to love and to love you. The one who taught me, the one who fed me, the one who wiped away my tears, the one who hugged me, the one who grieves with you. Women, behold your children. Children, behold your mothers.
The fourth word. And when that sixth hour had come, there was darkness over the whole land until the ninth hour. In the ninth hour, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, "Elohima, Elohima, lamana sabachthani," which means, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Of that glorious agony and torture of that day, the lacerations of that scorching, the chafing of the thorn around his head, the convulsions of his tormented, dehydrated body as it hung in the heat of that day. Nothing reaches the depths of the anguish of cry of desolation. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? Jesus, who found his purpose and strength in the presence of God, who was sustained by the immediacy of his relationship with God, and who endured by all the entanglements of power, always worked with him, always the center of his vitality and peace, found himself totally alone on the cross. Jesus, those very being of God, was found in himself utterly abandoned, isolated, despairing, cut off from all that gives him life and breath, cut off from all that gives him purpose and hope, cut off from the source of his being, cut off even from himself, purged in the depths of human condition to walk in the places of the utter absence of God, in the place of sinners, in the place of those who reject God. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? In these words, there is a certain mystery of the crucifixion which cannot be fully comprehended, that there was no despair so deep, or evil so overwhelming, or a place so far removed from joy, light, and love, from the very heart of God, that God had not been before us, and where God cannot meet us and bring us home.
The fifth word. After this, Jesus, knowing that all was now finished, said, to fulfill the scripture, I thirst. There is a kind of timelessness about hanging on a cross. It is not a quiet death, over in an instant, in one glorious moment of martyrdom, like being torn apart by lions. A cross is as much an instrument of torture as it is a gallows from which to hang. And as the day wears on, seconds stretch into minutes, which stretch into hours. until there comes a point when time can no longer be measured except in the gradual weakening of the body and its ever more insistent demands for that substance which is so vital to life, so foundational to all living things, so basic to existence as we know it, water. Water to moisten a parched mouth, water to free a swollen tongue, water to open a rasping throat that cannot gasp enough air, water to keep hope alive, to keep life alive just a few moments longer. Water to a crucified man is life. O God, thou art my God, I seek thee. My soul thirsts for thee, my flesh faints for thee, as in a dry and weary land where no water is. Who can tell if these words from Psalm 63 went through Jesus' mind? But a thirst for water is a thirst for life, and a thirst for life is a thirst for God, who promises streams in the desert, mighty rivers in the dry land, and living water to wash away every tear. Here, at the end of it all, those promises seem far away, distant. And yet Jesus, forsaken by God, still clings to the memory and the hope of life. I thirst.
The sixth word. A bowl was there full of cheap wine mixed with vinegar, so a sponge was soaked in it, put on a stick of hyssop, and lifted to his lips. Then Jesus had received the wine, and he said, "It is finished." What a sight of relief! What a cry of deliverance that finally, after seemingly endless pain and gasping of torture, it is over at last. The suffering is ended. The ordeal is finished, and nothing remains but a blessed peace of the absence of the serenity of all. The sensations are gone. When all there is pain, it ceases in its greatest blessing of all. Even when it ceases, it comes only with death. But Jesus' cry is more than just welcoming the end of pain. It is more than joy at the deliverance of death that it brings. He does not merely say, "It is over." He says, "It is accomplished, fulfilled, achieved. Jesus cried, "It's a cry of deliverance and defeat of despair. It's a cry of success and triumph, even at the moments of death. At the race of it all, the race has ended. He has run the good fight that he has endured to the end. And that strife is over. The battle is won. Jesus' cry is a cry of relief, of assurance, but also a cry of victory. The work I came to do is complete. There is nothing more to add. It is finished."
The seventh word. Then Jesus, crying with a loud voice, said, "Father, into my hands I commit my soul, my spirit." And having said this, he breathed his last. It is the end, the very end, the end of the ordeal, the end of the suffering. And Jesus, alone on the cross, tortured, exhausted, abandoned by his friends, forsaken by God, gasps for a last breath, and gathers the strength for one final cry. Why should he choose to speak so close to the end? Why would he muster the last energy he had to cry out with a loud voice? Couldn't God have heard his thoughts? Unless God wasn't the only one intended to hear. Unless his voice was pitched loud that we too might hear this final dedication of his soul. A dedication made despite the pain, despite the mocking, despite the agony, despite the sense of terrible aloneness he felt. A dedication made to God before the resurrection, before the victory of the kingdom, before any assurance other than that which faith could bring. Jesus entrusts his spirit, his life, and all that has given it meaning to God in faith. Even at the point of his own abandonment, when the good seems so very far away, he proclaims his faith in God. The darkness cannot overcome it. Father, into your hands I commit my spirit.
Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we have been esteemed and stricken, smitten by God and afflicted.
But he was wounded for our transgressions, and he was bruised for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement of the whole soul.
All we, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us have turned our own ways, and all the Lord has laid upon him in our iniquities of us.
He was assigned the grave of the wicked, and with the rich in his death. Although he had done no violence, nor was any deceit found in his mouth.
Lord, remember us in your kingdom, and teach us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.